Hey guys, this is the XRP Cowboy. Hey, this is Billy. Computer, play the end of the world as we know it. Interest rates are up, stock market's down. You're gonna get mugged if you go downtown. An earthquake, birds and snakes and airplanes. I guess I'm going to bitch you a little bit. We should start with Charles Hopkinson from ADA. You know, I'm a little disappointed in him. I owned ADA, but you know what I've always said? I invest in all kinds of speculative things that could make me money. But I heavily invest in CEOs, you know, heads of companies. Like Tesla, you know, back in the day. Not anymore, but I don't invest in the Dark Knight anymore. It cost the Cowboy a little bit of money when he tweeted out his 420 bullshit. Committed security fraud. But, you know, like VeChain, it's about the head honcho, Brad Garlinghouse. But when Charles decided to put his fucking foot in his mouth, and then he went on air to try to justify his actions in an indirectly, directly, I would say belittling way, tried to blame us. It was our fault that we lashed out at him. But if Charles had any fucking human decency or people skills or whatever, maybe that part of his brain doesn't work, he would understand. He was kicking a fucking man. He was kicking a cowboy when they were down with the heel of his boots. Charles, you ever think we might be hurting? We've been through fucking hell and back. You know, it's like your kid's been benched all season and he finally gets a chance to play and he fumbles it and some asshole dad says, "Your son fumbled the game, man. The ball cost us the game." You know? I'll tell you what, someone's getting hurt. That's certainty. Charles, I'm not gonna be so fucking nice. You know, you were cool when you supported us with the lawsuit and you said this is gonna affect the whole industry. That's right, it is, but it's not going to affect it the way you think. We're going to see clarity for the one, and people are starting to figure it out right now. We'll get into that. You know, the standard XRP, and you might be fucked and everyone else, because we're going to have the first mover advantage. And what if that clarity avoids what XRP did in Ripple, and they target everybody else, like the people at an ICO. Maybe they're not safe. Maybe that's how 99% of these cryptos go away, because exchanges won't be able to list them, and we see what happens with that. You know, coins go to nothing, unless you're XRP, I guess. We're holding through adversity. So that's one bitch. The other bitch is, well, it's not really with Jeremy Hogan, but it kills me. I'm trying to build a channel here, and for the last 2 years, you know, well, since this case dropped, I was saying how it'd be good if XRP, you know, that, you know, first one's through the wall of significance always gets bloody, you know, and I said it'd be good because they'd have first mover advantage on clarity, which could be even bigger than Bitcoin having first mover advantage. And he says it and people are like, yeah, fuck yeah. And I say it and motherfuckers don't listen. My dreamers listen and my roadies. But I'm saying a lot of these social media things. What else pissed me off? Well, I guess, you know, I always said Ripple was going to partner with Swift. and XRP was going to, you know, run on it, because Brad Garlinghouse said he didn't want to buy MoneyGram. He didn't want to take over businesses. He didn't want to compete. He wanted, you know, to be a part of them all, kind of like Microsoft did with Windows, Bill Gates. You know, it was brilliant. You know, but everybody thought that was a crazy idea. It's still not a, you know, certainty, but we hear a lot of people talking about that now, don't we? There's no replacing anymore, you know? And when I said that on social media, I got fucking slaughtered by the sheep. Or maybe it was the whales that don't want to see us swim. You know? What else did I write on my bitch card? I love my fucking roadies. Billy, you can have your dreamers, dude. But you're a bitch. Fucking bitch. I mean, inflation and interest rates going up, that's, it makes logical sense, but it doesn't make human sense. Like, there's no human side to, you raise rates so people don't have as much money to buy things, so consumers' goods have to go down in price so you can afford them. I mean, yeah, that will bring down product inflation, but you know what else does? Price destruction. If they inflate too much, the market takes care of itself. People just stop buying that individual product. I mean, it's all a lie. If you really want to get into it for a minute, I believe every crash that has ever happened had to do, major one was, or recession was, quantitative tightening. What they do is they print all this money and they buy securities, traditional stocks securities. And then they buy it with imaginary money. It's free. And it helps everyone's 401ks go up. And, you know, but this is why they tell you to invest, not trade. Because they want to, like, they don't want you to sell it at the top. When they decide to tighten, it's at the peak of the market always. And then that starts bringing the, you know, the market down. But you're taught to average cost down, or, you know, knowing that people are emotional, 90% of people are emotional thinkers, so they're not going to buy right away. And they're probably going to miss the bottom. Most people are not going to buy until it recovers. You know, a 401k is consistent. It happens no matter what. But I'm saying with just investing. So they teach us that, right? But really what's happening is, you know, they start tightening, which means they're selling their securities from that they bought while it was quantitative easing with imaginary money. And they sell their securities at the top. And as it goes down in value, we panic sell, and, you know, instead of buying, and ultimately what happens, or instead of selling before it happened, you know, what happens is they make real money, meaning your money, from it crashing. And then when it gets to the bottom and they decide it's the bottom, they buy, you know. Like, I think it was like 2 years ago, or 2.5 years ago, 25% of your traditional market was cut from quantitative easing. So what you think's going to happen when they start tightening? You live long enough, you understand this. We were all taught to be slaves to the man, to the job, to the government. That's my bitch about that. Inflation. What else? I mean, who really cares right now? But I will say this. Our time is soon. I call it moon soon. A moon soon of liquidity is coming our way. You know why? Because I'm certain. I have certainty. Does that mean I'm right? No. But, I mean, I told those guys in the money-making group, my friends, my brothers, like, when the CPI came out, Consumer Price Index, that, you know, the price is built in, fuck, It's dropping everything. And I was a little scared because I'm like, this doesn't make sense to me. Didn't make any sense. Computer, play in WA.
Here's some music by NWA.
You know, because it should have been built in. We knew this was coming. In fact, I actually felt it was better than expected. And I thought, bottom line is, built in the market. And, you know, it was like, we're going to hell in a handbag. And then I remember saying, in the money-making group, that this doesn't make sense. It was built in, you know, I don't understand it. And then I logged out, and 20 minutes later or 40 minutes later, the market started to do like a whipsaw back up. And I knew at that moment, it was just emotional reacting by, overreacting by probably retail that pushed it down that way, that low, and smaller investors. But once the whales that sold leading up to that, they had their sideline money ready to buy, knowing this would happen. Once again, the man, the whales that don't want to see us swim, that are taking our money because they don't have enough. Because it's never enough until it's all. It's like they, you know, their strategy is like a tournament Texas Hold'em player. You don't win until you have it all. And you can't have 95% of it. There's still money on the table. You need it. And that's how they do it. But anyways, I mean, I see explosive potential here. We just bounced off today like it was nothing. Last time I seen the price move like this, it implied a much greater move. That's why I like that 66. That's like my confirmation. You know, in fact, if it was a normal stock, in a long-term hold, I'd wait for 66 to buy it and to see, have it tested support at least one time, depending on what it was, maybe two, knowing I was giving up some gains, but not in this space. I just buy it whenever the fuck I want because XRP, because I know what I own. I'm buying bricks of gold to pave fucking my driveway, okay? Pave my kids' future, to give them their life so they don't have to pay back that inherited debt at the day you were born to buy your freedom back. They won't need to do that. They can do what they love, but they're going to work. They're going to do what they love and not because of the price the job they, you know, take pays what it pays. You know? I'm just buying my time. My time coins. My dreamers. My fucking roadies. Fuck Gary Gensler. But I'm... Oh, and just one more thing. This price... I see the price going to $2 and past it this time. And I'm saying without a settlement. I'm seeing explosive moves coming because a settlement is soon. You'd have to be out of your fucking mind to sell now. And if you're trading, you're trading with a lot less of your stack than you would normally. Because we're close to the finish line. And you know, it could be next week. It could be 12 months out. But that is a short-term return on investment. So right now, for me, it makes sense to buy it at 50 cents because it's a shorter term hold. It's not gonna, I'm not gonna lose on opportunity gains from other coins. You know, it's not gonna be a big opportunity cost. But point is they know that, and every day we get closer than that, it increases the pressure on these traders who are selling less and less to not sell at all. And on the people that were waiting to buy in because of the FOMO, you know? And, you know, big investors, they love turning a quick dollar. So the bottom line is, nothing lasts forever, not even a lawsuit. And whatever happens with that suit, it's going to work. It's going to be beneficial to us. How significantly, I don't know. And, I mean, that could be the difference between a $10 XRP and $100 XRP and beyond, you know? But what I do know is every day there's going to be more people buying and less people selling. That's supply and demand, and that's what price goes up. Without a settlement, at this point, you know, if you look at the circumstances we had when it went to $2 the last time, that is, yes, we have war, but overall, from an investment kind of perspective and not like an emotional perspective, we're in a much better position with XRP now than when it went rocketed the last time, because we really were still figuring out how this lawsuit was going to go, and we didn't know how strong of a case they'd have as far as what kind of evidence we weren't privy to. But at the end of the day, just that alone is going to make the price go up, you know? And you just got to decide, what are your sell prices? There's some people that might call it average cost selling. I would call it taking profit. That's what we've called it for many years. But I like it. It's got a ring to it. Average cost selling. My dream is my roadies. Hope you're doing well. I love you, Bull. Just giving you a shit. And what are you gonna do when the Hulkster?